So how many of you have ever watched a movie, watched a TV show, or been reading a book, and at some point in that show, movie, or book, you said either to yourself or to someone you were watching the show with, "I never saw that coming." You ever said that?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, we probably all have at one time or another, right? A plot twist is thrown in. Something that we didn't expect to happen happens. For some reason, over the last year and a half or so, I've been reading a lot of fiction books, a lot of kind of mystery, crime-solving kinds of things. And invariably, in each of those books I've read, there is a plot twist. There is a moment when I said, "Oh, I didn't see that happening." It's a character I've grown to like, who all of a sudden becomes the bad guy. And you're like, "No, not him." Or it's the main character that you followed along, and all of a sudden, he dies. And you're like, "Oh, that can't happen." Something happens that we weren't anticipating, that we weren't looking for. We expected, or I expected, the storyline to go in this direction, and the author took the storyline in this direction, and since that author's published, and I'm not, this must have been the right choice, right? Well, such is the case with our "I am" statement from Jesus today. A plot twist. Something that the characters in the story were not expecting, were not looking for, didn't anticipate. They thought something else, and Jesus wants to reveal to them something different about who he is and what he came to do. So, turn with me, or take out your phones and iPads and flip open your Bible app to John chapter 11. We're going to read verses 17 through 27. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe that you're the Christ, the Son of God, who was to come into the world." Now, those words that we read, they fall right in the middle of a story that is probably well known to most, if not all of us. And even though it's well known, let me recap it for us so that we have an understanding of where the words that we read fall in the context of what's going on. The story that is told here in John 11 falls into 3 parts. The first part, verses 1 through 16. Jesus is ministering near Jerusalem, somewhere around Jerusalem, close to Bethany, somewhere in that general vicinity, and word comes to him, a messenger is sent from Mary and Martha to tell him that Lazarus is sick, gravely ill, not just a little, but that he is gravely ill. In fact, many think that by the time the messenger gets to Jesus, Lazarus is already dead. Lazarus and Mary and Martha, his two sisters, are very close to Jesus. They are good friends. In fact, some believe they were almost like family. It's believed that when Jesus would minister in or around Jerusalem, he would stay at their home in Bethany. So when this news of Lazarus being gravely ill comes to Jesus, we would expect, we would anticipate, the plot would lead us to believe that Jesus is going to drop everything that he's doing where he's at, and he's going to rush to Lazarus' bedside and grab his hand and do something amazing in Lazarus' life right then, right there, without any delay. And yet what we see is the exact opposite. That not only does Jesus not rush to Lazarus' side, but he stays where he is an additional 2 days. And finally then, in verse 15, Jesus talking to his disciples, he says, okay, Lazarus is asleep. Let us go to him. And they go together to Bethany, which we then pick up where we read in verse 17, which is the middle part of the story. Verses 17 through 37 are the second part in which Jesus comes to Bethany, and before he even gets to the city, he is encountered by Martha and Mary, and he has this series of conversations and interactions with the two of them, plus with all the mourners who have gathered because of the loss of Lazarus. Now, one little side note is that there was a profession back then known as a professional mourner. How many of you want to sign up for that job? You want to talk about having trouble getting up in the morning to go to work? I would think that would be a tough job to get up for. Anyway, Jesus encounters all of these mourners and has these interactions with them in this middle section of the story. In this middle section of the story is the verse that we all have memorized, right? John 11:35, Jesus wept. We know that one by heart, right? Anytime you ask someone, hey, give me a verse you've memorized, I'm like, Jesus wept, right? But the reason Jesus weeps at that moment is because he is angry and frustrated with these mourners and these people mulling around who disbelieve who he is and what he can do, and at this whole situation that's going on with Lazarus. Now, because the part that we read obviously is in this section, there's much more to that that we need to unpack, so we'll come back to those verses in a few moments. But after that then leads us to the third part of the story. And this is the part of the story where Jesus gets to the tomb where Lazarus has been laid. He calls for the stone to be rolled away, and he says, Lazarus, come out. And, much like a mummy movie, Lazarus comes out because he's all wrapped up in the burial clothes. In fact, everyone is so astonished that Jesus actually has to say to them, could you go help him? And Lazarus is alive, breathing and whole and restored to his family. Now, verses 17 through 27, specifically in verse 25, Jesus proclaims, I am the resurrection and the life. The central point of the story. You see, before he comes into Bethany, while he's still on the road that leads into the city, Martha hears that he is coming, leaves her house, and rushes out to where he's at. And there they have this conversation, they have this dialogue in which lies this plot twist, in which lies this I didn't see that coming moment. Because when she gets to Jesus, she says two things to him that are important to the story and to Jesus' response of I am the resurrection and the life. The first thing that she says to him is, if you had been here, nothing would have happened to Lazarus. Jesus, if you had been at our house, if you had been in this place, Lazarus would still be alive. The second thing she says is, but even so, I know that if you ask something of God, he will give it to you. Now, what's the significance of what she says? Two thoughts coming from her words for us The first is this idea of Jesus needing to be present in Bethany. She is suggesting that Jesus' power is limited. She, in essence, is saying, or by saying, Jesus, if you had been here, nothing would happen. She is, in essence, saying, see, since you were somewhere else, you don't have the power to help, to do anything, to bring healing and wholeness. You needed to be here. And so she's limiting God. Because while Jesus was fully man, he was also still fully God, and therefore he had all the power necessary to heal Lazarus regardless of where he was on this planet. But he waited. Now, why did he wait? Why didn't Jesus drop everything when he heard the news and rush off? He tells us himself in verse 4. He says, so that God, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified. Later in verse 15, when he finally does say, okay, let's go, he goes so that the disciples will increase their faith. He stays an additional 2 days so that God is glorified and that through that process, people will come to have faith. In him. Jesus' timing was perfect. And it wasn't about him being there or not being there. It was about the way that the fact that things work in God's timing, not ours. The death of Lazarus came about so that God would be glorified. And as we read at the end of the story, so that others would come the faith in Jesus. Now, the second thing about Martha's statements is that we see Martha's weak faith. Martha knew Jesus very well. I'm sure they had spent a lot of time together as friends. And yet her words that God will do whatever Jesus asks are not words that are based on a strong conviction of faith. She doesn't really believe that Jesus, in that moment, standing right there in front of her, entering the city on that day, that he can raise Lazarus back from the dead. She thinks that because Jesus wasn't there before he breathed his last, that all is hopeless. And we know this because of how she responds in verse 39. Verse 39 is Jesus has gone to the tomb, and when he gets to the tomb, he says, roll the stone away, and instead of jumping up and down and saying, yay, Jesus, you're going to bring my brother back to me, she says, oh man, the smell's going to be really bad, Jesus. I don't think we should do this. She doesn't believe that Jesus has the power over death once death has come. You see, when she said, whatever you ask, she didn't really mean whatever you ask. Verse 24, she states that Lazarus would rise again, but not until the end of time. Not until the last days. Not until everybody rises again. She never thought, she didn't believe that Jesus could raise Lazarus back to life right then and right there. So, since Jesus and Martha had been talking about life and about resurrection and the restoring of life, and how Martha has pushed all of that to the future to say, yes, someday down the road I understand that everybody will be raised up. I get that, Jesus, and that's okay. In response to that whole conversation, Jesus gives verse 25, and he simply says, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. Here lies the plot twist. Here lies the moment that Martha would have said, whoa, I didn't see that coming. You see, Martha wanted Jesus to heal her brother. But when that didn't happen, when he died, when life left him, she couldn't believe that Jesus could bring him back. At least not right then, at least not right there. To Martha, any chance of seeing her brother again was gone until the last days. She felt hopeless. And to that line of thinking, Jesus looked at her and he said, "Martha, you're not hopeless, for I am hope, because I am the resurrection and the life." Now, what are the implications of Jesus' saying that? First of all, he is saying he is resurrection and he is life. All of that is bound up in him. All of that is available because of him. In the Gospels, we see Jesus raising people back to life. There's the widow of Nain, her son, right? They're in the funeral procession. They're carrying the coffin of her son. And Jesus passes by and he sees what's going on. And he stops and he says, "Rise." And the coffin lid comes off and the boy sits up and he's restored back to life, back to his mom. We know the story of Jairus, the Roman soldier, the authority of, who comes to Jesus and says, "Hey, my daughter is sick. Can you help? Will you help?" And Jesus, as they're walking to his house, a servant comes to him and says, "Don't bother him anymore. Your daughter is dead." And Jesus says, "No, she's not dead. She's just asleep." And they continue on. And he restores life. Jairus' daughter. He gave life there. But here he is claiming, "I am resurrection. I am the restoration of life." In the Gospels, Jesus spoke about life. In John 10:10, we looked at it the last 2 weeks. "I have come that you may have life and that you may have it to the fullest." Jesus talked about the road to life being a narrow road and only a few get on. And how if we really want to have life, we have to lose it. In John 11:25, he's saying, "I am that life." The reason John 10:10, the reason he can say, "I've come to give them life and give it to them in the full," is because he's saying, "I've come to give you me. Because I am what Jesus is saying is that eternal life and rescue from death are not merely gifts obtained by appeal to God. They are aspects of what it means to live a life in association with Jesus, in relationship with Christ. If Jesus is life, then those who believe in him will enjoy the confidence and power over death known by him. They will have a life now and don't have to wait till the end of human time and history in order to enjoy the benefits of Jesus' power. Because he is resurrection, because he is life, we can experience all of that right here, right now. That's why it was a plot twist to Martha. She couldn't see it as right here and right now. Jesus is the overcomer of death. He is the sustainer of life. The second implication of Jesus' statement, then, is the question that he asks Martha at the end of verse 26. He says, "Do you believe this?" After he says, "I am the resurrection and the life," he goes on and elaborates that. And basically, he says, "If you believe in me, you won't die." Now, he says something that could be construed as contradictory, right? He says, "If you believe in me, you won't die, but even if you do die, you'll still live." And you're like, right? But he's saying, you will never die spiritually. Your spirit will live on with me and my Father forever. Yes, you might die physically in this life, but you will never die spiritually. You will always be with me if you believe. And to that, he says, "Martha." I almost have this picture of him grabbing her face in his hands, saying, "Martha, do you believe this? Martha, do you know this is true?" It's almost comforting words, but yet challenging words also. As if to say, "Martha, I've heard what you've just said. But here's the real story. Here's the real plot. Do you believe this? Do you trust in this? Do you have faith in this? Do you have faith, Martha, that I am the Son of God and I have lordship over death? Do you believe that I, as Jesus, that I and I alone can raise the dead and give life eternal? Do you believe that I can raise Lazarus right here and right now?" So then, there are a couple of takeaways for us as we think about the story of Lazarus and Jesus' statement of I am the resurrection and the life. And the first one is, don't put God in a box. You ever done that? I think probably we all have at one time or another. We all have limited God. We all have put boundaries around who God is or what we believe God can do. We scale down His promises. We limit what He's capable of. We say, "No, you know what? I like God right here. Up on the shelf, where He's there when I need Him, but He's out of the way when I don't." And so we limit God. We put Him in that box. We put Him in that picture frame because we all have this nice, cute, neat little picture of what God is supposed to look like and what our life is supposed to look like. And as long as the two mesh, we're good. But when one gets out of whack, well, then we're like, "Eh, I don't know. It's a little uncomfortable." Because when God is in the box, we can control Him. We can determine what's right and what's wrong. We can determine how our life's supposed to be because it fits within the box. But God doesn't fit in a box. Right? I mean, God bless all the shoeboxes that we send, but God doesn't fit in that little box. God doesn't fit in a box. Those picture frames, they have borders and limits. But God has no limits. But Martha was trying to limit Jesus. See, she thought Lazarus could only be healed at the end of time. She thought Lazarus could only be healed if Jesus was right there. She thought Lazarus, that once he was gone, that Jesus was of